Hey, welcome to the Linux channel. So as a part of kernel data structures, especially kernel networking subsystem data structure, I shot various episodes on sk-buf data structure, net device data structure, IP header, UDP header, and stuff like that. So you can go through the same in the video index. But recently I just started a new video series on struct socket and struct sock data structure, because these are quite interesting data structures, because anytime you do user space socket programming, it is in the kernel side, it is actually these data structures and the APIs corresponding to these data structures comes into the play even before passes your data as a part of network packets in various layers or network stack, like IPv4 stack, and within IPv4 stack the transport header, network header, and stuff like that, before it gets passed down to dev core, net core, device.c or dev.c, and then subsequently into the device drivers. So this is what essentially I have discussed in the whole big picture and Linux kernel networking subsystem. I shot various episodes on the overall big picture so that you can identify each and every module and where exactly it fits. And apart from that, I have also discussed quite in depth about each module as and when it came as a part of kernel programming and as a part of various data structure. So I highly recommend you to watch the same even before you watch this video. And in the first episode, as a part of introduction and the code walk, I have discussed the various header files which has this struct socket and struct sock dot struct sock in include net sock dot h and include linux net dot h. So in this you can find the same. So what I can suggest you is, while watching the video, you can keep this page open so that you can understand where I am trying to point out, and you can use all these references, and you can you can maneuver according to the way I am discussing in the video. So if you see the data structure, the flow of various APIs, the implementation of various APIs are being done in the net socket.c for struct socket, and whereas in the case of sock struct sock, it is done in net core sock.c, as you can see here. But the more interesting part is net socket.c, because this is where it corresponds to, immediately it corresponds to the network flow diagram of Linux networking subsystem. So if you go down here, I have attached a quick link of this image, so you can see it is coming from Linux Foundation. I just done an image src and then I have added in this page so that you can quickly refer, and also attach the link so that you can open in a new window like this. So you can see here, essentially, initially, even before going down in the networking stack, you have this entire socket subsystem. So essentially what is happening is, you have this kernel space and user space. I'm not sure how far camera picks the same. Anyway, you have this user space and the kernel space. So right below this you have the socket layer or the socket subsystem, and below the socket subsystem is your entire network stack is implemented, and then right below that is your device drivers and stuff like that. So we are at this point of this picture, right just below the user space, so that you do any socket code, right after that it is this place it exactly comes. So you can see here, once you are done with that system calls, essentially whatever you do with the socket, send message and receive from and all that, it is essentially translated into a system call, and essentially it is getting passed into the kernel space, and this is what essentially it is. So you can see the entire upper layer, upper area is about sockets, and over here it is also about sockets. The entire, the downmost region is all about network you know, internal subsystems like IPv4 stack, and within IPv4 routing and input output and various other, you know, modules. So that is what it is. So in this case, you can see here it is a send message, which means it's a TX from user space to kernel space, and from kernel space it is going into the network stack, IPv4 stack. In this case, for example, it can be IPv6, it can be anything. So it is going into the kernel other modules, and then it is getting to the NIC card essentially. So whereas in this case it is about you know, receive message. You can see here SOC_receive message. So it is a part of, you know, RX path. So essentially the packets are coming, and then the device driver captures these packets and then passes it to the netcore dev.c layer. And from there it gets classified. If it is an v4 packet, it goes through IPv4 stack, net IPv4 stack, or else it is v6 packet, it goes through net IPv6 stack, and finally it comes to the, you know, socket layer. In case if it is supposed to be passed on to the user space, sometimes it can be a network appliance. In that case you may have a routed packet. So, or sometimes if you configure your Linux system as a bridge, layer to bridge, in that case nothing happens, the packets will come, and the VR the net bridge module will check, and then it is going to forward it like any layer to bridge without any layer 3, no parsing of this layer 3 headers. So this is what happens. So let us take example, like it is done from a local host to some remote system. So this is what technically happens in any socket code. So that's what it is happening. So this is as a part of, you know, receive, which means the RX path, whereas in this corner it is about, you know, TX path. So that's what it is. SOC send message. You can see here they have highlighted the hierarchy net socket.c. so in this case, this place it is net socket.c as well. So this is what it is. So right after that it is going to the, you know, stack. So that's what it is. So in the first episode I have discussed about the struct socket, the member variables. You can see here it has this you know, socket operations. So I was a little confused while shooting the video about socket options and socket operations. So this is about socket operations. So that is why I just put a message saying that it's just a small correction. So you see here, this is where you have this data type struct proto ops, which is nothing but socket operations. It can be bind, connect, and all those operations. So if you go to the source, you can find here you have various operations. You have this you know, struct socket here, and then below that you have this various you know, socket operations. So if you see here, you know, this is what is highlighted in this picture. If you see here, send message, as a part of send message implementation, you can find it in net socket.c. you can see here, you can see here SOC send message. I don't want to go in depth because you have various APIs like copy from user, copy to user, and these are some of the things which once I have discussed in IO control series, video series. It is quite interesting. If you are not yet watched, you can watch the same in this video series. In that I think in the last episode I have discussed about the same. So you can see here SOC send message, and this is what is mentioned over in this, you know, picture. So you can go here, you can see here it is having this abstract API SOC send message, and then it is pointing to here, and you can see here it is nothing but it is pointing to this function, you know, pointer passes. So SOC ops send message. So this is what is socket operations, which you can find here. Okay, you can find here OPS. So this is what, in case if you little further dig down, you can find each time you have this this send message may correspond to, if you dig down further, if you click and dig down further, okay, if you click and dig down further, this particular thing which is going to point according to the socket type or the protocol type to its corresponding send message. So if it is a UDP, if you can search like this, if it is UDP, it is going to point to net IPv4 UDP.c, and if it is SCTP, it is going to point to net SCTP socket.c or somewhere like that. So you can see here there are various protocol specific operations. You can see here the send message is corresponds to UDP is UDP send message, and that has been allocated to this send message. So it will eventually divide further down inside. So this way, whereas if it is something like SCTP, you can see here that send message corresponds to over here. So let us go down in depth in the subsequent video episodes. Right now we can just hover across netsocket.c so that it is much simpler to understand as a part of this architectural diagram of Linux kernel foundation itself. So this diagram is from Linux Foundation. It's the best diagram which I always refer. This is the reason I'm just including in my video series so that you can quickly go and you can verify anything in case if you want to verify. So similarly, you can see here in the case of RX path, you have the socket receive message. So that again we can search in this net socket.c. So this is so you can see here receive message is over here, socket sock underscore receive message. So similarly, like that send message, you have this API. You have the another case like security socket receive message and security socket send message. I'm not sure what is that security variant is. I may later dig down. Anyway, for now I'm just sticking something which is immediately apparent and immediately easy to understand, something like this. So you can see in this case receive message is over here, and it has the similar look. Sock is nothing but struct socket, and sock ops socket operations, and then pointed to receive message of within that socket operations, which is nothing but a function pointer. So this is what it is. So again, if you go here, you have the same sort of mapping over here. So that essentially maps to UDP underscore receive message. That again, if you click, you can find its implementation as well. So you can see here its implementation, and you have a minimal documentation over there. So this way you can go down a protocol specific implementation, and then you can and trace the flow. And you can also do one more thing is you can also use this diagram, and also you can do is you can also trace through this way as well. In this diagram you can see here, as an example, sock receive message, in this case it is done through TCP receive message, whereas I have picked is UDP as an example, whereas in this diagram they have picked TCP as an example. So if you go here and if you search, so somewhere you can see here net IPv4 TCP IPv4.c. Let us see. Yeah, you have this TCP variant of TCP receive message and send message, and that it's pointed towards send message and receive message. It points to these APIs. So again, in this case also you can search TCP send message, you can see, and you can search, and maybe it will be implemented in the same file, or if this file is quite bloated up, maybe they may implement in some other folder, some other file. So you can see I'm searching the same, it looks like it is not implemented in this file, which is still okay. And in that case, you want to search where it is implemented, you can click the same, and then you can find its corresponding file. You can see here it's been implemented in net IPv4 TCP.c. So this way you can trace down, you can find its source code, how it goes further down. And exactly this is what is mentioned in this Linux architectural diagram as well. So you can see here net IPv4 TCP.c, and then further it goes down to various other network stack layers. Similarly, if you go here, same thing happens with the send message. You can see here TCP send message, since it's a RX path, they are just pointing down, and then it goes to TCP send message, and further it goes down, and then finally it goes to the IPv4 stack, IPv4 layer, because I'm sorry, the entire thing is the TCP, whatever you are seeing in this context itself is IPv4 stack, and within the IPv4 stack it will go to network layer. So further if you scroll down, it will go to network layer. You can see here I don't want to go in depth because it itself is a separate stuff. I'm not focusing much about traversing this network architectural diagram, because this is something little bit I have done as a part of, you know, networking subsystem. So here I shot so many episodes, I think it was totally some 7 episodes I have covered. So in depth I have covered already. So this is the reason I don't want to go in depth into the same. So this is the reason I highly recommend, in case if you are very new to Linux kernel programming or especially network programming and stuff like that, and you are very much interested in the kernel part as well as the user space part, I highly recommend you to start something, a topic like this, a networking subsystem. Start watching from the first episode. These are the videos I have shot around 2 years back when I just started this channel. I'm very new to the camera, this model of the camera, which is a Nikon D5300, and I'm very new to operating, in terms of operating this camera, lighting and various other stuff. So the video may not be that good, but as far as the information is considered, it is quite useful. It is as same as useful as this video, but only thing is the way I shot is different, and I was a little bit stumbling and stammering, and on top you have this sort of, you know, poor lighting and you know the screen capture, audio quality of the screen capture and stuff like that. So hope you guys loved watching this video. So in my subsequent episodes we cover some more things within that socket layer, and then we can see how far it traverses down across various other network layers or IPv4 stack layers within the same. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you have any questions, send an email. Thank you. Have a nice day. Bye bye.